Good evening and welcome to Sundaram Mutual's for webinar series called the E.M.I. That focuses on the updates on the economy, the markets and investments.
Right. So the key thing about the world economy, and I think to remember, because to those of you who have been in the markets for quite some time, you'll remember the global financial crisis, right? And where each country took its own decisions and the crisis lasted for a very long time. But this time, the synchronous actions and the results thereof are what is noticeable, right? What is the synchronization? First, there is a medical crisis. So the vaccination across the world, millions of people, in total of 900 million vaccinations have been administered as of 17th April, right? So naturally, the United States leads, but India is third there. So I think a good, and India, as you know, exported the vaccines to all the needing countries. And multiple vaccines were, of course, used by various pharma companies. But I think this has been an excellent example of the world cooperating with each other. The second thing is the liquidity, right? Here you can see here, I've shown the 2009-13 global financial crisis and the 20. And the three biggest global liquidity providers are the US, the Eurozone, and Japan. So here you can see how between that period to now, there has been a multiplier effect. The US has consistently maintained 80% of its balance sheet expansion, but Eurozone, from 9% in the previous crisis, they have gone to 63% of their balance sheet in the previous crisis. Japan, of course, being less affected, did not need to do that. So as a result of this, right, the flood of liquidity in the current year is about $13 trillion, which has taken the stock markets up all over the world. But what is the good news? The good news is that up to December 22, that is this 21 calendar year and 22, another $29 trillion is expected to be pumped in. So I think on the liquidity front also, you're seeing the coordinated actions of the big nations and the impact is likely to be there for at least another 2 years is the current reading, right? Apart from this, what it led to was that China was the first place where the crisis hit. So China was the first to recover, and Chinese recovery naturally has an impact on the world recovery. How? Because China is an infrastructure-driven country. And so if you see copper demand, steel consumption, and aluminium demand, China has been driving the commodity prices, the metals prices up. So the metals rally has been something that China, being the first of the blocks, has driven. At the same time, oil prices, which crashed and then showed some signs of rising, have kind of stabilized because the liquidity, that is the amount of oil in the market, has been controlled by OPEC and US and Russia and the Saudi, right? So the supply has been fairly stable. As you can see, they don't want the oil prices to go down, nor they want it to go up and affect demand. So there's a synchronized action by the oil producers on this also, right? At the same time, what's the outlook? We believe that the China, the lending was the one which drove the infrastructure. But now, as you can see here, the lending has gone up, which means there's not much more space to lend in the China. So we don't expect this metals rally to be sustainable just based on the China growth. I think that has reached its peak, and the metals rally will now depend on other factors like an American recovery and all of that. So if you now look at the overall globe, right, you look at the new order index for the globe, right, this shows you that across the world, the new shows that it is at a multiple month high. The America is at a 200 month high. Euro is a record high, and others, it varies from 7 months to 90 months. So that's the synchronous global recovery being spotted. And if you now look at the GDP projections for the world, right, overall 2020, and these are calendar year numbers, friends, not financial year, what we see in India. So if you see the world IMF projections, right, global growth was -3.2 in the calendar year that gone by. This year is expected to bounce back to 6.7, but in the next calendar year, stabilize at 4.6. You must be wondering why it's coming down. That's because the reason 2021 is showing a jump is because of the base effect of a negative growth in the previous year. The following year, you will not have a negative base effect. That's why the growth numbers are tempered down. A small quick peek at India here. If you can see, it is the second last line there, right? So India in the calendar year last year showed a 7% negative GDP growth. But in the next year, that is the current running calendar year, India is going to be the fastest growing country in the world at 11.6, aided by the fact that we had one of the sharpest drops in the previous year. So the base effect is helping India with the projection of a double digit growth. But next year, it will again moderate down to a 6.5% standard growth rate, right? So this is just a snapshot. I want to now take the world discussion onto one country, that is the United States of America. Why? Because as you know, it's the American economy and clue as to the world recovery and the behavior of the stock market. So let's spend a little bit of time on the American economy. What actions and what results? So the American economy has been printing notes, right? So because of that printing notes, you saw the numbers, I'll show you the numbers again. The fiscal deficit of America has risen. So the effect of the fiscal deficit, twin deficit means current account deficit and fiscal deficit, means that the dollar gets weak. So the first thing is that fiscal deficit of any country, if it goes up, it means their country's currency becomes weak, because currency is the sign of the strength of the country. Just as the share price reflects the strength of a stock and the company behind it, currency price reflects the strength of the country, right? So that's what it's telling you, that this US expansion, the note printing, has led to a weakening of the dollar. It's a very important point to note, because this dollar weakening will come up again during my presentation. The main factors behind what's happening in the world, that's number one. Number two, the US also, can you see the liquidity? They sharply bumped it up last year. This year is going to continue. And up to next year, they're going to pump in $9 trillion more of liquidity. So if this US note printing continues, the fiscal deficit is going to expand even more and the dollar is going to weaken. Right? Next is that all this flood of liquidity, plus the fact that people haven't spent money during the lockdown and due to the virus, means the excess of savings is poised to give a boost to consumption in the US. There's a large pool of excess savings waiting on the sidelines to come and boost consumption. That's the story of the US. Normal consumption has already come back to the pre-COVID level, which took about 3 years in the previous crisis, has come back within a year here. Third thing is that between goods and services, the consumption spend on goods has jumped up far higher than that on services. That means goods are generally borrowed money. So it gives a boost to the economy because of the interest rate cycle and everything else, right? At the same time, from the supply side, new businesses, small businesses, right? In the global crisis, they were flat for almost 3 to 4 years, but you can see now that they have jumped up. New businesses, small businesses, and if you look at the small business sales, you can see there's just after New Year, there's been a sharp jump in the sales. So all that's happening on the US seems to be a good news, that all of their actions are actually yielding purely from an economy perspective. And so if you then look at the manufacturing PMI in the US, you can see a sharp V-shaped recovery at the end, right? Hotel room occupancy is another indicator, has come back to Jan 2020 levels, right? And if you take the various states' manufacturing surveys, all of them are showing different levels of a V-shaped recovery, right? So to summarize the US story, the blue wave is important. What is the blue wave? The Democrats coming to power, not only as the president, but in the House, the Senate, and the Congress, both are Democrat controlled. So that's an important thing for them to execute whatever they are thinking. So second, unlike Trump, Biden has stopped interfering in the monetary trade wars or a thing of the past. While there is still strain in the US-China relationship, at the same time, summarizing the world now, we already saw that the recovery is well entrenched. We saw that 900 million doses of the vaccine have been administered, plus a positive Brexit deal has been inked. So the uncertainty around that part has also gone away. And hence, for the current year, a continuing flood of liquidity is going to be there, adding $300 billion a month. And so with this, with the dollar weakening story, there could be spouts of dollar strength on US growth, if whenever that comes through. So this will give a structural fillip to emerging market equities. Both liquidity and dollar weakness always gives. I'll show you a slide later. And like I said, commodity strength, we don't expect it to sustain. And there is enough output gap between demand and supply that no fear of inflation is there right now, right? So from that point of view, let's shift focus to the domestic market, right? Where the headline tells you what we think about India, that India is riding the recovery. So what is the best indicator of that? The GST collection. One GST has come as one India, one tax rate. The GST gives you a sense of economic activity because every activity, the government gets a share of the income. So from a V-shaped recovery, which is growing to strength well above 1,20,000 crores. So I think the GST numbers clearly tell you that there is a recovery happening in India. These are the other generic economic things as the truck freight rates. So Delhi, Mumbai, Delhi, Calcutta, Delhi, Chennai, Delhi, Bangalore. You can see all of them. The freight rates go up. When do they go up? When the demand for the trucks rise. So second indicator of strength. The third, PMI. Strong V-shaped recovery. Yes, there is some moderation because initially it was a pent-up demand. Now there is a slight bit of a moderation, but still on a above 50 level, right? Good progress on the vaccination, right? We have just in 2.5 months, all the vulnerable population, 60 years and above, we have managed to vaccinate. And the number of people vaccinated also has been rising day upon day upon day. So good progress from India. As you know, from May 1st, all people 18 plus and above are going to be eligible to be vaccinated. So once you know, we know average age of India is 28 years. So once you do 18 and above, the whole population should have got a level of immunity, which augurs well from an economy perspective, right? And this second wave, which is happening, that is a key risk which we need to be aware of. Why? Because if you look at the state-wise nominal GDP, Maharashtra accounts for 14% of the country. The top five states account for almost 50%, 47%. But these are the states which are getting affected. Maharashtra, UP, Karnataka, and Gujarat. Tamil Nadu, less so. But you can see that this is a key risk that we need to see on how the second wave impact is managed, right? And then, however, we think it will be well contained. Why? Because if you read what's written on the right-hand side, right? We feel that states are more reluctant to impose lockdowns, right? Because they are concerned now over the economy. Second, we believe that there's a pent-up demand which will offset the weakness again. So once the wave is controlled, the pent-up demand will come up and make up for it. Third is that we talked about the vaccination drive. And finally, industry is much prepared this time around to deal with the crisis. So I think all of that means that we think that the second wave impact is likely to be well contained, right? That's on the economy part. Let's move to the companies part. So Reserve Bank's action as a balance sheet expansion, like the world, has also been instrumental in helping the recovery. As you can see, a sharp increase in liquidity. The latest policy, they said they will continue to support on a liquidity perspective. But this is not just liquidity. It was also rate cuts. So severe rate cuts were also instituted by RBI to make it easy for corporates to raise very cheap money. Today, 90-day to one-year money is anywhere between 3% to 5% corporates are able to raise. This next action of the RBI, apart from liquidity rate cut, was the resolution. We had 5 months of moratorium, two moratoriums. The third one, instead of that, they instituted a committee, and 66% of rated companies in India have got the benefit of the resolution framework. So overall, good companies in corporate India have got a benefit, right? So as a result, if you see, the banks have also been smart. They've increased the provision on the non-performing loans in this period sharply. You can see I've named a few banks there. You can see all of them have increased their provisions. In fact, the specific COVID provisions also, anywhere between 1 to 4.5% they've raised. Only Bandhan had took a little more hit because it was in the microfinance space, right? And overall, collection efficiency has remained in the mid-90s. So large banks have been able to manage the overall crisis very, very well, which augurs well for the economy. The third aspect, Reserve Bank, we covered, NPAs we covered, and the budget we covered. As you know, these I've covered it in detail a couple of months ago, so I will not dwell on it here. So what I will tell you is that the CapEx growth is the key. 5 key sectors, 25% YOY growth in capex: roads, railways, defense, water and housing. And if you see overall, the headlines reads, budget builds all the right narrative with the fiscal mathematics for support. To summarize, it was a pro-growth budget with very little to dislike. I've summarized few of the points, but I think we have seen the budget enough. So let me move forward now to the summary of this, is that we expect a V-shaped recovery with contained second wave impact. So if you see this quarter, that is April, May, June, we are expecting to post a 28% GDP growth. What is the reason? Because the previous quarter, YOY, last year, April, May, June, was minus 25%. So you've got to remember that the base effect is helping. The next quarter, it will temper down to 14.5 and 4.8. So probably on a projection, we are looking at slightly over double-digit GDP growth. You saw the IMF is predicting 11% for the current calendar year. And we think from a fiscal year, number should be broadly there, right? This is the economy up to now. What is it that the markets, when they put money, they don't necessarily look at what is happening right now or what happened in the past. They are looking at what's going to happen in the future. And that's where the budget was a trigger in terms of capex. But there are three key domains which are a very positive sign for India going forward from a stock market perspective. This is the housing sector, the PLI initiative, and the NIP. What is the NIP? National Infrastructure Pipeline. Let's look at each of these, because these are the multiplier things that are going to come and support our country. So first is on housing. What's happened in housing is that a combination of low interest rates, 6.7% for a 30-year housing loan, and property prices also stabilizing, and income levels also remaining flat, means that we are now at the best ever affordability level of 27% of a person's salary, last seen in 2003-04. So this means that, you know, in addition to that, some states are giving stamp duty waivers also, or reduction, sharp reduction in stamp duty. So that combination means that today, property price to income ratio has dropped from 6.3 to 4.2. And in fact, not only for staying, today, if you take a housing loan and give the house on rent, it's never been cheaper to buy that. That differential in 2012 between the post-tax interest that you pay, you know, income tax gives you a deduction from the interest you take on a borrowed property, and the rental income, that difference was 7% in 2012. Today it's 3%. Means 3% you put from your pocket, you can buy a house and rent it out. And then as property prices rise in the future, that 3% will collapse and go, and you may even be surplus. So it's a very good time to buy a house, even as an investment. So this is something that has going to have a multiplier effect on the economy, because for every house that is built, you have demand for steel, you have demand for cement, you have demand for wiring, electrical wiring, you have demand for wood, you have demand for paint, you have demand for sand, you have demand for PVC pipes, sanitary ware, tiles. So you can see 9 to 10 industries get a boost when the housing sector goes through a boom. And the condition is right. So one of the big drivers, obviously, who's going to benefit? All of these industries, plus the real estate sector and the housing finance and the banking sector. So you can see this is going to have a very strong positive result on our GDP. That's housing. Second is the PLI. What is PLI? Production linked incentive. What is this? This is nothing. Government has identified a number of sectors, 13 to start with, where they said that any foreign manufacturer comes and sets up business here, manufacturing unit, what the government will do is give him 5 to 6% of his value addition, which is sales minus raw material cost, right, as incentive for 5 years. And after that, government says, I'll earn money from you from whatever sales you do. So 5 years, effectively, your tax break is given and cash is given to these companies. So naturally, this is going to be a huge booster. These are the 13 initial ones. And as you can see here, value addition is a percentage of GDP. 1.6% is the expected benefit. And this has been facilitated with the tax rate cut, which was announced earlier, from 35% to 17%, among the best tax rate in the world, plus our ease of doing business ranking having changed by 79 ranks. And the fact that the opportunity is coming from a comparison with China. But China is the manufacturing capital of the world, but their population, the red line, is declining, the working age population. Our population is going to rise for the next 30 years till 2050. So COVID has further hurt China because people realize that over-dependence on one country is not good. So 44% of people in China, those who are manufacturing, are saying they're looking to relocate. And this relocation is not just small ones, but substantial ones. So to that extent, our country's PLI program is actually a part of targeting a China plus one thought process, which has come into global manufacturers, right? So that was the PLI scheme. The third thing which is going to give a boost is the National Infrastructure Pipeline, NIP. We saw that the budget had increased the allocation to CapEx. We also know that the government has laid out a 1 trillion, 100 lakh crore expenditure over a five-year period. Where is that money going to get spent? Largely into four areas. Energy, urban infrastructure, roads, railways account for 70% of this 100 lakh crore to 70 lakh crore. The spin-off benefit, I don't need to repeat. Cement, steel, tar, road construction, employment generation, building materials, all of that is going to get a boost. So these three strong drivers are the ones which give a positive feel to India's economic growth, right? And if you see there, already the engineering and construction sector, the order backlog is bottoming out. And so there's indication that all of this is working. So moving from the economy to the stock markets, right? Let's look at the markets from a macro perspective. What do I mean macro? Right at the beginning, I spoke about how the dollar index, right? A weak dollar helps emerging market equities. So here we have mapped the MSCI emerging market index with the inverted dollar. So can you see how closely they're moving together like husband and wife? That means that a weak dollar is very positive for the economy. So that's been the story, that when note printing occurs and fiscal deficit rises in the advanced countries, their currency, the dollar, becomes weak, and that is a positive for emerging market equities. That's number one. Why this is happening is because the capital flows are directly correlated to the dollar index. That's point number one. That's what we are showing here, the dollar index in red and the capital flows in blue. The third thing is that actually global liquidity helps companies' earnings go through an uptick. Why? Because low interest rates translate when liquidity comes in and companies' borrowing costs go down. That's part of the answer. Second, liquidity also means that the money flowing helps the companies to raise money from the capital markets and hence bring down their debt. So not only the lower interest rate, the amount of debt coming down is definitely positive. So that's what we have shown here. The first one tells you the net worth of NSE 500 companies. Second one tells you the debt of NSE 500 companies. And third tells you the debt equity. As you can see, equity has, net worth has gone up, debt has come down, and the debt equity ratio has improved. So this is why we're saying that a weak dollar plus liquidity actually not only leads to more flows, but also leads to improved earnings. And that's the point I want to say, that this improvement in earnings. So if you see here, the MSCI India performance versus the analyst revision. What is analyst revision? Every company, you know the consensus. When the Infosys reports an earnings, they say it beats consensus or didn't beat consensus. Means all the 40, 50, 100, 200 analysts put out there saying that this is what we expect Infosys EPS to be. So analysts, when they revise, they can revise it down or up, right? Because the company actually reports it better or worse. So as you can see, analyst revisions have been going upward, which means that the improvement in the EPS is even better than what the analysts expect. So naturally, they revise the next quarter's consensus. And when you do the revise the earnings, the valuations look cheap and the prices rise. So I hope I've given you a summary snapshot of how liquidity plus a weak dollar ultimately results in the stock prices moving up, right? So that was the macro on the market from a FII perspective. Looking at the domestic markets, right? The Nifty's earnings last year was 536. This year, we're expecting it to be 713. These numbers are pre the second crisis. So the crisis factors will probably bring this down. is not yet updated for the latest forecast. In fact, the forecast itself are not ready. People are still coming to terms with the second wave and its impact. But pre that, it was 713, and next year a sharp jump. So this forward EPS expectation is partly what has been driving FII flows into country and helping the large cap index to move up. But overall, if you look at the valuations, this is the P ratios of the three indices. All the three ratios have just moved past their long-term average, right? So they are tending to get a bit expensive, but they're still below the peak. If you can see, each line is still below its peak seen in the last 3-4 years. So valuations still, we believe, appear reasonable. In fact, if you use December the 17th as a previous high, the Nifty's valuation has gone from 17.8 to current 20.2, which means the valuation has expanded or increased by 2.4. So it has become a little more expensive. Whereas a mid-cap index was then at 24 PE forward, today is only at 14 PE forward. So there has been a correction in the valuation of mid-cap from that peak by 10. And the small cap was at 20, 19.9, is also down to 18.5. So it's at a 1.4 correction. So overall, if you look at it, inter se, if you compare the mid-cap index to the Nifty, it's at a 31% discount, whereas it was at a 35% premium then. And the same thing about the small cap, from a 12% premium, 11.7, it is now at an 8% discount. So we believe that mid and small caps are reasonably attractively valued. And the reason for this is also that from a forward perspective, we can expect earnings of mid and small cap to improve as the economy improves. So this graph where you show phase 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 basically tells you about the bull cycle, bear cycle in the Indian economy. So you take the first cycle 2003-08, which we have been tracking, you saw that Sensex went up 559%, mid-cap went up almost double, 900%, and small-cap went up almost triple at 1400%, right? So now when you come to the new phase, which we believe started with the corona correction in March last year, you see the large cap index has gone up 90%, the mid cap index has gone up 108%, and the small cap index has gone up 133%. Yes, so the small and mid cap already started outperforming it since the crisis, but the difference is still very narrow. In a true bull market, if the economy really doing well, that difference will be very, very sharp as seen from the past. So ahead, we see that these are buying opportunities from a broader market, mid and small cap perspective. Now, everything can't be good, right? We have to be prepared for risks. So the second wave was a risk, which we saw. But apart from that, so the first risk is unabated COVID-19 infection flow. That's the biggest risk is to our theory. And naturally, so we have to keep a close watch on how the second wave progresses. Next set of things is abroad. The top line talks about the world and the bottom talks about India. So if you look at it, we have been expecting, it has been, dollar has been weakening, and we're expecting that. But the strength in the dollar, which over the last month or so, if you see, rupee has gone from 72 to 75. So dollar strength instead of weakness is a risk, which for India will mean a sharp rupee depreciation. So that's a risk because we import crude, we import a lot of goods, and all of their values will go up. Next, if the US gets through a sustained rally, then commodity prices. So far, the commodity rally was China-driven. But in the next phase, if Europe and US come to thing, then commodity price rise could lead to inflation. And that inflation could lead to US inflation and Fed paring back their bond purchase, which is akin to what happened in the tapering. And that could create an earthquake in the markets. Similarly, for India, the risk around that is that we get a bad monsoon this year. So if there's a bad monsoon forecast, then we can expect food prices to shoot up. And so commodity inflation will come in and feed into our economy. And RBI will then shift its focus to inflation from growth and start cutting liquidity. So be aware of these risks, which could negate all the bullish thoughts that so far I expressed, right? So to summarize now, so this is the world summary. I will not read it. I will just point out certain highlights. So for us, I think if there's a good monsoon, rural India remains strong, then that's a good sign for consumption, right? The other thing is that we expect a return to the investment cycle with both investment and consumption.
So from a portfolio strategy perspective, this is the way we look at it, right? Our Sundaram's approach is to price in the evolving situation on the ground and keep scouting for good businesses to buy, right? And what do we position for? The investment cycle resurgence and the secular consumption story, growth story. In the domestic story, we feel that increasing exposure to quality financials, banks as well as NBFCs, discretionary consumption, building materials, auto and industrials, right? And any global recovery that's happening, we believe that metals, specialty chemicals, auto industry, and IT services will be the sectors to play if global recovery is seen coming back fast. Indian IT companies, we believe, are in a very good position because they're benefiting from this whole migration to cloud and the whole digital story, right? But stock selection is giving more and more importance. And we think, as we saw you, mid and small caps are expected to, right? So with that, I will end today's presentation.
Mutual fund investments are subject to market risks. Read all scheme-related documents carefully.